So I'm Catherine Lindell from Michigan State University. And even though I'm at Michigan State, I'm a New Yorker, so I'm really glad to be back here. I was born in Utica and then grew up in Oneonta. So, and I was just visiting my mother when this workshop was scheduled down in Oneonta. So it's really good to be here. And thanks a lot to Jim and Laura and Julie and Paul for putting this together and giving us this opportunity to share some of the results with you. So I will try to talk loud. If I don't talk loud enough, please let me know. And I'm just going to talk about a small part of the project that we've been working on right now and some of the economic and consumer perspectives that Paul mentioned previously. Okay, let me go to the next slide. Okay, so the title of this talk here, just to give it a focus it a little, birds and fruit crops, economic and consumer aspects of deterrence. Some of the people who really worked hard on the data that I'm going to present here, one of my grad students, Megan Shade, Bill Howard is our consumer person on the project, Aaron Anderson and Stephanie Schwift do the economics work.
I apologize, I'm messing with my other screen here.
Okay, just mentioning where people are from. So I'm from Integrated Biology at Michigan State. Then we have other people, Phil Howard from Community Sustainability and the National Wildlife Research Center in Colorado. That's where our economists came from on the project. Okay, next. So even way back when, this is Audubon, one of his illustrations, he noticed that birds eat a lot of fruit crops. Okay? And here's some of the types of damage, which some of you, I'm sure, have probably seen. We've got apples, cherries, grapes. Okay, and then here's some blueberries as well. And this work involves a lot of field work out in fields. Here's the blueberries, go ahead. And then here's the sweet cherry crop as well. Okay, as Paul briefly mentioned, we're trying to integrate a number of different things in this project, and they involve both consumer responses to bird management techniques, economics, and ecology of the different interactions between the fruit crops and the birds that use them. And, you know, when we consider all these things together, then we hope we're going to get the best strategy for bird management. Okay. You know, so one thing we're particularly interested in doing is facilitating ecosystem services. Oh, sorry. This looks like, is that? Okay. Skip the next one. That seems like out of place. Okay. So here's the results of some of the economics work that we did. So, and some of you may have heard of this previously, but we sent out, and Bill Seymour is going to talk in some detail about this, but a couple of years ago we sent out over, got 1,600 responses essentially to a survey that we sent out to fruit growers in 5 different states. And the work was published a couple of years ago, but I just want to give you a brief sense of what they found here. You know, in this column, we have the percent respondents who were growing a particular crop we were interested in, and we know the costs that were involved. We asked them about their yield per acre, how much they were spending on bird management. And then we also asked them to estimate what their percent loss to birds was, and this involved their current management, what they were doing and what they were experiencing. And then we wanted to get estimates of what they had, what they thought they would lose if they engaged in no bird management, and what they thought they would lose if they and their neighbors did not engage in bird management. Okay. All right. So this column right here, we said to the growers, if you didn't engage in bird management, but all your neighbors kept doing what they were doing, this is what they estimated their yield loss would be, okay, compared to their current losses here. And then this right here, no management, was we asked them, if you didn't engage in bird management and also none of your neighbors did as well, so no one's engaging in bird management, and so the estimates here are, of course, higher. All right, so all these data were combined with local price data, you know, so prices vary across the country, acreage per state, and then we came up, yes, with the next slide here, and so this was trying to monetize the bird damage and what it costs these different states. So, for example, in California, and this, again, is sweet cherries here, the estimate was that they were losing $12 million because of bird damage to sweet cherries, all right? Now, I'd like to point out these columns here, too. So another part of the project was to estimate what are the benefits of engaging in bird management. So I'd like to point this out because it means, you know, that the efforts you make to control birds actually have some real benefits that translate into economic benefits for the state. So, for example, in California, the management efforts of the growers are worth, at the low end, potentially $19 million, and at the high end, $26 million. Michigan, you know, we don't grow as many sweet cherries, but losing about $2 million because of bird damage, but the efforts of the growers in bird management are resulting in benefits of $3 to $4 million. So that's what these data are saying, that bird damage is costly, the management efforts are helping growers and regional economies, but of course we could do better. And then I'll show this slide again in the next talk, so just you'll have a sense now of what it all means. Okay, you can go ahead. Okay, some of the results I'm going to be talking about now are from this area of Michigan, which, if you know Michigan, that's our big kind of sweet cherry grape apple growing takes place. There are other parts of the state as well, but that's where a lot of this research is based. Okay? All right, I want to talk about one in this talk, this is shorter, a small component of what we've been studying here. This is an American kestrel, a small predatory bird, and we had heard from our colleagues in the Pacific Northwest that growers out there were using it for bird management. And we had certainly in Michigan, and I don't know to what extent New York, but some growers had been using them for road management. So putting up boxes for this species, and what's nice about them, because they use cabbies, you can draw them into particular places if you put up nest boxes. Because over time, you know, more and more people kind of cut down old snags on their property where this species would originally nested for safety reasons and things of that nature. So often you can get them to come onto your property. Okay, go ahead. Okay, so here's an example of the nest boxes that we put up in cherry orchards in that region, northwestern Michigan, okay? All right, and then I had this student, Megan Shafe, who's been a terrific worker, and she's developed some really nice techniques to monitor the reproductive success of the birds and also to assess their diet. So, you know, she's got, like, this is a pool skimmer. She attached a video camera up here. Then she has this portable video screen down here and this battery pack she carries around. And she can monitor things without actually taking the nest down. Okay? Okay. So one of the things she wanted to do with the diet assessment was figure out what different types of prey they're taking and are the potential crop pests and what are the proportions of different prey they're taking. So she used video recording for the prey delivery, these little security cameras that are really cheap, so it was a nice cost-effective method. They're like 30 bucks, and she would put them inside the box and then see the birds coming in, and she could see what they were bringing. And then she also looked at, they produce these pellets, you know, they regurgitate their stuff they can't digest, like bones and feathers and that kind of thing. So I'm going to be mentioning the video camera data here, okay? All right, so let's see if this is one of our videos here. This is an example of a female kestrel, and she should be showing, oh no, this is a male, showing up with a grasshopper. Okay, and then we have another one here, just, I think we need to go back, yeah. And then this should be a female showing up with a bowl. Okay, so from those data, you know, she's gotten hours and hours, thousands of hours of data, really, to look at what their diets entail. See, and this is some of the data from the pellets, you know, just the types of insect parts, remains that we get, and then they're also taking, you can go ahead there, they are taking birds as well. So she's found starling remains and robin remains, and they're not nearly as common as the arthropod and rodent remains, okay? And then lots of mammal prey as well. Okay? All right, so this is an example of the type of data. These are 8 different boxes that we put up. You know, here's the number of hours of videotape she has of them. And then here's the proportion of the different prey types in the diet. So the green here is arthropods, insects. Red is mammals. Blue is birds. And then you've got some other. But so keep in mind, these are just number of deliveries. It's not biomass, these different prey. But you can see it's really weighted in 2013 towards arthropods. They were bringing lots of arthropods, many fewer rodents and birds. Okay, go ahead. 2014, things changed. So these are the same 8 boxes, these first 8. And you can see they were taking much higher proportions of rodents. in this year, in 2014. And we think this might have been linked to a couple things. I mean, you may remember it was a really bad winter before 2014. And so sometimes small male populations are higher when you've got a bad winter because there's a lot of snow cover to protect them. And also some of the videos from earlier in the season, so maybe insects hadn't come out yet. But so just giving an idea, it really varies from year to year, the proportions of different prey types that they're taking. Okay? And this is, you know, an extrapolation. So here's the average number. If you look at the entire nestling period of kestrels, that's about 30 days, and they've got young in the nest. You know, one box or one pair of kestrels is going to bring in about 1,800 insects, 71 mammals, and nearly 50 birds. Okay, next one. And then, for example, this year we had 16 boxes up. And so, again, if you extrapolate from the data, what's the average proportion of birds, mammals, and insects? They're taking in, you know, 16 boxes would result in about 30,000 insects, over 1,100 mammals, and about 760 birds being removed from the environment, the whole landscape that they're working in. Interestingly, also, the kestrels have been a declining species in North America for the last several decades. And in this region where we're putting up the boxes, they've had a significant population decline. So it's nice from a conservation aspect as well to use these boxes, okay? All right, so this is another part of the research that was based on consumer preferences for bird management techniques. So Phil Powers, who is at Michigan State and does a lot of work with fruit consumers and food consumers, he had some focus groups where they talked with people about bird management strategies that they would prefer or not prefer or were neutral towards. Okay? And then he used the data from the focus groups to design a survey that went out to 1,000 consumers in the United States. And he used a company that matches, you know, for example, I think it's race, age, and gender. You know, the general population in the U.S., they match the numbers of individuals who answered the survey. So it's not, it's supposed to be balanced depending on groups. So the questions of the survey were something along these lines. If apple A was produced using live ammunition as a bird management technique, it was of local origin, and it was a certain price, would you prefer this apple, or would you prefer and buy this apple? So apple B would have been, you know, bird management would have been this methylene free spray, this artificial grape flavoring, again, of local origin and what price. So it was all these kind of choice questions that they used. And so the results were interesting, and you can go ahead to the next slide. All right, so in this graph right here, you've got a line right down here. And what this is the reference to which other things were compared. So the reference bird management technique was the live ammunition, which Paul mentioned, which is just to kill a few birds and scare the rest. And so they compared that for apples, you can see here, and grapes, you know, and different bird management techniques. So if this line is your reference, you know, consumers tended to be willing to pay more per pound for grapes or apples that were grown using falconry as a bird management technique or these predator nest boxes, okay? And they were less enthusiastic and willing, not willing to pay as much for the artificial grape flavoring or methylene pyrenoate spray as a bird deterrent. And so what's interesting here is also here's the preference for fruits of local origin. So you can see that the preference for certain bird management strategies was equivalent to the preference people have for fruits of local origin compared to generally. So this is just a nice piece to the project because I think it shows you may be able to use this in marketing. So you can go ahead here. And a few fruit growers are trying to do this around the country. So this is a vineyard, and they you know, are advertising on their website. They are putting up nest boxes. And I'm not sure if it's kestrels. Also, people put them up for barn owls, which take a lot of rodents. And next slide. Here's another example of a vineyard that's using it in marketing. They're drawing in barn owls with nest boxes, okay? All right, and just to mention briefly, there's also work being done on the benefits of bluebirds. So these are species with eat a lot of insects. And there's been some work in California vineyards showing that they eat some insects that are particularly detrimental to the crops out there. And interestingly, again, they can be drawn into particular places in nest boxes because they use cavities, okay? And just another site of the voracious bluebirds. Okay, so here's some take-home messages. So installing predator nest boxes is a low-cost way to enhance removal of potential crop pests from agricultural areas and potentially increase the local population size of predators. It's not going to solve all your pest management problems, all right? But it is low cost, it's low maintenance, and we haven't quite closed the loop yet. So we're looking now at whether having Kestrels actually results in diminished activity of birds and rodents in fruit crops and whether that translates into reduced damage. So yes, yeah, we're working on that. Okay, next one. And then informing consumers about your predator nest box use will elicit at modest price premiums for fruit lovers. Okay. Then here is our website for the project, and this has information from the project that you may be interested in. There's a handout, but I have a sheet that I got that has the website listed on it. It also has on the sheet, you know, the part of the website you can get to that has a fact sheet about how you put up special nest boxes, because, you know, ideally they are facing the southeast, and there's some other parameters you want to think about, okay? And then here's some special thanks to some fruit growers that we worked with, the SCREE project, Northwest Michigan Horticulture Research Staff. And I think that's it, just more bird damage to the fruit crop. Anyway, I can take a question or two. Yeah.
All right. Kestrels are territorial.
Right. You can't put them closer than half mile together. Okay. So how close can you put Kestrel boxes together? Are they territorial? Yes, they are. So you can only put them every half mile or so. And I would also say, you know, you can't put Kestrels and bluebird boxes together on your property because then the Kestrels may have, you know, poured on bluebirds for dinner. We've had a problem with that. So nuances and pluses with it.
If you already have Kestrels, does it make sense to put up a box or just let them
naturally? You know, I think if they're already on your property, I don't think you need to put up a box. They may prefer the box. But I don't think you need to. That's great that you have them already.
Have you been able to assess the current value of the Kestrels? So if you're going to 20, 48 birds in a season or something like that, any sense of just having them coming in and out, maybe deterring some bird damage?
Well, my grad student right now, she's been collecting data to follow up. So she's been doing transects through orchards with and without boxes and Kestrels. And it's been counting the number of, you know, potential pest birds she sees. And so those data are out there, and she needs to analyze it. And she's also got a plan to look at mammal damage in the winter and see whether orchards that have had Kestrels have lower mammal activity. So we're still waiting on that. Yes?
Any techniques out there for tracking that
to techniques for you mean for their local abundance?
Exactly.
Okay, question about whether you can track populations of predators. So we're doing some of that. So my grad student has been, you can do transects, and I was doing some this summer too. You walk along roads and you look and detect them, and then you can analyze the data and see whether they're more abundant in some areas than others. And so yeah, we can do that now. Would these swap boxes where they play distress calls deter Kestrels? And we think not, because we have some video, you know, of Kestrels using nest boxes, and in the background you can hear these swap boxes going. So it seems like, you know, they start nesting quite early in the season, so they're probably already going by the time you deploy those types of things, and it's unlikely they're going to be able to because of those. You need to move on.
Okay.
Thank you.